Greetings, YouTube. So as a kid, I used to build malls in quantity. That was one of the cool hobbies for 60s and 70s kids. Later on, I got more serious about it, did some local IPMS contests, and I eventually got into other things and sort of dropped modeling. One of the things I got into is RC scale modeling, which was pretty fun. But all these years later, I decided to do a model again, plastic model. I had a bunch of time to kill. So I wanted something complex. That was an aircraft, and I love the mosquito. So I ended up finding on eBay a good price on the Airfix 124th mosquito. This is sort of the wreckage and aftermath of having finished that kit. There are some sites in the UK that Well, there's one in particular that has these at a pretty good price if you're looking for a new one. But I just kept an eye on eBay and found one that was pretty well priced. So one of the things I wanted to do was kind of update my modeling skills. There's all kinds of stuff that wasn't available when I was younger, including quality acrylic paints and a lot of techniques and tools, including the lead wire. Never knew about that back in the past. So, and then of course did a bunch of research. The internet and Facebook has some sites which are really good, including a restoration in the UK, and of course model forums to get scale references in addition to the books and publications that are available. But what I wanted to do with this model was kind of go give you some tips here and some gotchas that I encountered that might help you avoid some of the pitfalls with your model, and also sort of go over the areas that I think are kind of a must-have if you want to really do a scale model, and especially a competition model. So just as an overview, this is a huge model. I looked at the Tamiya 1/32 scale mosquito, and I had this on a table with a built one of those, and this absolutely dwarfs that. It's big. It's so big, it's actually a little, it didn't really fit properly on my workbench. And one of the problems I had, I use these incandescent lights, and I left a wing too close to one of those, and it melted a huge dent here that I had to fill and repaint and fix. It's prone to hangar rash. It's really easy to smack it into things. And then in the house, I have kind of no place that it'll sit on. So it's a beast, which is good and bad because it's structurally challenging. When you put components together, they're very strong as units, but they go together and produce a pretty flimsy kit. The wings are flexible. You'll hear cracks and groans. The worst thing for me, this I'll start with the landing gear. I was warned to use the metal aftermarket landing gear struts because of the weight of the model, especially as I was adding lead detail. So the nacelles are built entirely before they're mounted on the plane, and one of the other things, the stock wheels and tires are horrendous. So I got these resin aftermarket wheels and tires, which are beautiful, but inexplicably the axles, the holes for the axles are drilled much bigger than the kit or the aftermarket axles. And it's kind of funny because this is the only 1/24th scale mosquito kit, so I'm not sure why that happened. But what you end up with is these two struts are, they want to walk like that, right? And there is all the complicated, scale struts and linkage and all of that stuff. That has no strength whatsoever. And also, it's not really located or secured to ensure really good alignment of your wheels. I had trouble with the toe on one of these. It just got wonky. I took this to an IPMS contest and was immediately eliminated because of the toe in that wheel. funnily enough, I brought the model home and it actually bent a little bit. I was able to put it back, but you know, I wasted all day at an IPMS contest. This is a huge gotcha in here. There's these two long struts. One of them slots neatly into a groove, so it's really held in position. The other one is just glued to the back panel there. That has no strength whatsoever, and if and when that pops off, you're going to lose all the alignment in your axles, in your landing gear. So there's a couple things I'd recommend. Don't commit to final assembly of the landing gear and gluing everything in place until the nacelle's on the plane. You have to assemble everything, but it doesn't mean you have to necessarily glue it. I had to pin. It was very difficult mixing the plastic kit materials with the metal landing gear. So be aware of that. The CA was finicky, even with accelerant. It didn't always stick. It was kind of a mess. So the landing gear broke the contestability of this model. And also, like I said, it's very fiddly. So, and it's very complex. One of the things I was a little miffed about at the IPMS contest was this landing gear has more parts in it than some of the entire models I was competing against, the 1/32nd scale models, by far, actually. And especially with the scale details I added. So, you know, it's a bummer to kind of throw away something because of that. But that's one of the problems with this model. You would think that, you know, these big massive parts would kind of go together easily and create a very nice presentation, but it's kind of the opposite. Everything is heavy and stiff and fiddly and doesn't want to bend and doesn't want to conform. So there's a lot of work just trying to precisely put it together. And then everything weighs so much and it's so, you know, easily broken. You have to be very careful with exerting the right amount of force on things. So that's my biggest kind of issue. There's a couple areas in particular which screwed me up with the mix of delicacy and strength. One of them was the ailerons. Note these ailerons have no detail on them whatsoever. This kit is unfinished. It's obvious that Airfix released this before they'd finished it. There's a number of areas. The inside of all the panels and gear doors are completely unfinished. You know, it's challenging modeling a Mosquito because most of the surface is wood. It was smooth without a lot of panel lines. But, of course, the ailerons were metal. I did end up riveting and adding detail to the top side. Didn't do the bottom side. But, yeah, so if you like adding detail, this is a good kit. If you like out-of-the-box detail like a Tamiya model, this is not a good kit. A tip on these ailerons, they had some pretty cool little tabs to locate them into the hinges, and those were one use only. I test-fitted the ailerons. They all just snapped off, and I had a hell of a time mounting the ailerons after that. It just, again, it kind of screwed it up. Getting panel fit was very difficult. So there's a mixture of strength and delicacy you have to be careful of. You know, manhandling these nacelles into the space and gluing them with all these different attachments, top, bottom, sides. I mean, that was also very challenging without breaking something because stuff didn't just plunk right in. Plus, the dihedral of the wing is set by, you know, properly getting that into that space. So, it was challenging. Okay, so just be aware that it's an oddly undetailed kit, but that, you know, allows you kind of a blank canvas to do stuff. A prime example of that are the engines. The kit came with all the really nice copper, you know, you have to paint this copper tubing for the cooling, and some of the wiring like this for the engines. These engine mounts are extremely frail. Every single one of these pieces broke taking it off the sprue. The weight of the engine on this kit is supported by this lower cowling, is not removable, so the weight is kind of held by that. But while you're working with it, these parts are very delicate. This is a huge engine bay with giant, visible detail, and most of it is just not there. This prominent space at the back of the engine bay is occupied by the rods that come through the wing for the throttle and mixture controls. Those are completely absent from the kit. The rear hoop on the engine mount's missing. All of this wiring's missing. All little boxes are missing. All the connectors are missing. So, again, nice blank canvas, but don't expect an out-of-the-box model to look very scale, because it's so big, you can see the huge areas where there's nothing there unless you put them in yourself. But the delicacy of these engine mounts was an issue all the way through working on the details. I even ended up having to glue wire behind some of these to try and strengthen them enough to be able to kind of touch and handle them. So that's a challenge. These exhaust shrouds, I scratch built these. They're not awesomely scale. That was about the best I could do. They're completely missing from the kit. And all of the Mosquitos in this era had these. So again, here's another weird thing. The spinner goes on to the propeller hub, and this the propeller glues into a little tiny tab in there, so it's rotated, and of course that broke somewhere while I was working with it. But notice the spinner has no backplate. It uses, visually, it uses the front of the cowling as the back of the propeller. I probably should have done something about that, made a back plate. Again, it's a big giant kit, and you can see there's nothing in there. So, weird. Very weird. Let's see, what else? Okay, so there's not, at this time, when this kit first launched, there was a reasonable amount of aftermarket parts for this. Nowadays, the only things I could really find were these nice, the cast resin wheels and tires. And again, the Airfix wheels are basically blanks, and the tires are rubber knobbies. So they're terrible. They're also too narrow. But I bought the photo etched radiators. When I first did that, I didn't think they were all that impressive. But when this was finished, they did add a nice touch. I didn't use the aftermarket cannons. Those are actually pretty nice. They've got nice barrels and stuff. I didn't see a lot of value in that, but I did get the, see if I can get that to focus, the brass 303 barrels. Those are nice. But what was really terrible was that these ammo feed, they're rubber. They were part of the tire sprue. You're supposed to paint them, bend them into this position. Well, first of all, they don't like to bend. Second, paint doesn't stick to them. And third, there's absolutely no ammo detail whatever in here. I painted them, and while wrestling them into place, because again, this thing is heavy and thick and things don't like to move, all the paint flaked off. So I had to repaint these in situ. If you look at the cannons, they're rather beautifully detailed, including the 20 millimeter shells clearly being in the ammo chutes. And again, those are the stock barrels and everything. So that's a really, again, the kit's kind of schizophrenic. There's parts that are so beautifully detailed and others are completely missing. Now, I went and did all that wiring and all that harness detail. Judges didn't even look at that. They looked at the bottom for about 2 seconds. And a lot of the stuff I did turned out not to be all that visible on the finished model. So kind of be careful where you put the time into detailing stuff, because some of it's a waste of time. But anyway, so let's contrast there. You know, again, the 20 millimeter ammo chutes. And then here on the front of the model, the most prominent thing, nothing. I mean, there's just a little tiny indent. I put the straps on here myself. I ended up wiring all the pneumatics for the guns, and then when I mounted it, it's all invisible. So, yeah, there's, this engine detail that's high on the engine is very visible. The stuff on the underside, not so much, even when you display it on a mirror. I think you and people who followed this on a forum are the only people who are ever going to see the detail I put in the front there. And the inside of the wheel wells, the walls were fairly detailed, the doors not at all, and none of the wiring or anything was in there. So was disappointing. Anyway, so if you want to do it, it's awesome, but a lot of it doesn't show. There's actually a whole wiring system there on the side of the bay that you can't see. But it's cool. I mean, it's a good representation of the plane when you're done. Okay, so another thing is that these nacelles have no rivet detail whatsoever. Apparently Airfix, I don't know what they were thinking. I mean, how do you do a giant model with no rivets? The nacelles are completely made out of metal. The panels, the sides, the back, it's all metal on these planes. So I played around. I've done different kinds of riveting on scale RC models. I got a, what is it, a Mr. Riveter wheel or whatever they call that. Not only wouldn't it indent this pretty thick plastic, but it was way out of scale. So I ended up kind of hand riveting this with a punch, which was semi-successful. It's not perfect, but anyway, it was bad to me that those had no rivets on them whatsoever. And so when you get around the edges of panels and things, there's also no detail. So you could spend a lot of time adding that if you wanted, but don't expect it to be there. On the Tamiya kit, there's a little reinforcing plate along here with rivets on it. There's nothing at all like that. There is on the real plane, on later post-war models, there's actually a reinforcing strip here. Even on the wartime models, there's kind of a visible seam there where the spars are. I scribed those in. Those weren't part of the kit. So in this scale, when you don't have scale details, the thing looks like a toy. It was difficult throughout production, especially I ended up at the end with several coats of flat varnish, more than I would have put on, because any shine on this thing, especially on the fuselage, made it look like a toy. Okay, so that's some of the detail. I did a ton of cockpit detail, and it's just not visible. There's just, other than the seat belts, there's not much point in going crazy over the wiring detail and stuff in the cockpit. Now, the kit comes with wrong radios for every version they modeled. I wanted to do this scale, so I built the little GEE radios out of styrene and put them in there, and then also the whip antennas that went with that. One of the most challenging things with this, I was new to the acrylics and generally really liked them, especially the fast drying. They didn't stick well to the canopy at all, so the canopy ended up with multiple versions and types of paint, which made it a little different than the rest of the plane. But one of the weirdest things about this kit, there's aftermarket part, or there's extra parts in it for versions that they never have sold. And so the canopy has the side panel here. There's just this window here in three versions, because depending on where it was built, there was a kind of a bulge or a bigger bulge on that window. Well, they had a very crude giant step there where you were supposed to glue it, which can't be hidden. God, I worked on that forever. So very non-scale, no rivet detail whatsoever on there. But yet the frame underneath is pretty scale. I mean, it's got the flare gun hanging there. So yeah, weird. So that was one of the biggest challenges of the model. Anyway, I put it on, it made the canopy warped and it was clearly visible. Fortunately, it's in the green camo part, not the gray section. But anyway, and then this scale 124 scale seat belts are probably the most complicated, difficult thing I've ever made. So those aren't just some photo etch, stick them on there. I mean, you had to make every strap and buckle on there go together, but it was challenging. It was kind of interesting. Spending a lot of time on the instrument panel, total waste of time. I mean, I've got scale maps in there and a lot of other details. Cockpit was pretty well detailed out anyway. Okay, so another thing is that the basic decal set that came with this is crap. The decals are very crude and oversized. I got the Barracuda stencil kit. I wasn't sure I needed that, and then I got it and I realized I really did. First of all, there's many, many more stencils based on better scale research, but this, don't step here, keep off panel, is a really prominent part of this kit of a Mosquito. So I was sort of a masochist. I actually cut it out of the decal sheet because it did have clear here. And of course it disintegrated when I put it on. It broke into 50 different pieces. I suppressed the urge to scream and stoically toughed out reassembling every piece in line. And I think it was really worth it. I think that looks pretty realistic. It's certainly a scale. And throughout this model, there's all kinds of stencils, which I've kind of faded to make a more scale. But anyway, that's a really good upgrade. The Montex masks I painted. So this box that comes with all these late war models, the decals are all 1945 planes, which is pretty much not at all how this kit is equipped. But anyway, so I got masks to paint these. I'm not a masochist enough to paint that, so those were nice in the kit. The tail flash was good. I wanted to do a specific plane that I researched, so I got these custom cut in England as masks. Those are really cool. There was nice, I got some aftermarket support for doing interesting paint with the markings, so that was kind of cool. It's a big plane. You need a lot of paint. I used an entire Vallejo bottle of green to accomplish just the green camouflage, and I'm on my third bottle of this ocean gray. If you're going to primer this thing, you're going to need a lot of primer. And also, when you varnish it, I ended up with the big size of these varnishes. By the way, this matte varnish is amazing. It's completely clear, sprays nicely, and is really nicely flat. And again, for such a giant plane, that's real important. Bafflingly, the tail had raised rivet detail on the elevators, which is, at least there's rivets, that's not scale being raised, but there they are. Had to fix that. You know, you can see the panel detail that's in there is pretty crude. The kind of fabric stretching molding was poor. It's kind of handy though. There is no panel detail on a Mosquito horizontal stabilizer. It's absolutely smooth. So if you don't like rivets and panels, this is a good thing to model. There's also nothing on the fuselage. There is a reinforcing strip here on all Mosquitoes that was missing from the kit. But in some kits, it's like this big giant hoop. In reality, it's more of kind of some doped fabric. So I painted that on. And a lot of raised fastener detail. So there's no kind of indented rivet detail except here. And this is really kind of horsey. So, yeah, it's a challenge to make this not look like a toy. I spent about 500 hours on it. You know, probably 100 hours of that detail stuff I did was not necessary. It just ended up not showing. There's a whole bunch of stuff behind the pilot and navigator seat. I made a beautiful panel back there. No detail at all in the kit. Pretty much can't see anything except the one tube. In the Mosquito, the mixture and throttle controls are linked to these tubes that run through the wings out into the engine bay. So they're, like I said, they're prominent. I made them out of styrene. That was kind of fun finding good references for that. And again, the hoop here was missing. The way that the inside of this lower panel is molded, you cannot help but get a big gap. I mean, a really big gap. This is the only panel that actually has detail on the inside. So you have to kind of fill that with fake oil to get it to disappear because you can't, there's so much rib detail in there, you can't fill it. On the scale of ejector pin marks, this is fairly high. It's not as bad as, say, a trumpeter kit or something, but every gear door and bomb bay door and cockpit, everything had a million ejector pin marks. You know, that kind of sucked. The nice thing, though, with this big giant sheet was that you could actually scratch out a lot of those with a flat X-Acto knife instead of having to fill them. But that was kind of a bummer. The bombs had kind of strange lack of detail. The noses would have either had this hoisting hook or a fuse, and they didn't have either. They just had a pointed tip. I made the hoisting hooks because in my model, it's being worked on. They wouldn't be working on a plane with live bombs on it. So, you know, again, who, did that matter at a IPMS meeting? No, the wheel being slightly towed out was the main thing. But for your own satisfaction, I mean, that's, you know, kind of nice. You can add detail. Another fiddly thing I had a lot of problems with was just the hinges. The actual hinges on the plane are kind of fat on the outside and taper to a tiny little point on the inside. And I thought it would be smart to install the hinges before I closed up the sides of the fuselage and put the canopy on so that I could just attach the door. And well, predictably, they both snapped off. So I ended up kind of non-scale having to glue the door to the fuselage and just do a lot of gluing to get that thing to stick. So kind of, you have to really think about the assembly order. You know, the Airfix instructions are just pictures. They're not necessarily in a logical order. So think ahead, really think about what's going to be blocked off that you can't work on. You know, again, with these very stiff and heavy nacelles, jamming them into the, you know, I get that piece that's on the nacelle, that's going into that piece, which is on the wing. It all has to fit. This goes down into a flat piece that doesn't fit well. Then there's another piece in here. All of this aligning, well, remember how delicate all of this is. You're going to be hearing crunching and yeah. So, think about reinforcing things as you put it together, too, especially those engine mounts. Man, because you don't get to put the back of the engine mount into the slot until this is all finished. And so, but you have to work with that for a long time. So there has to be a certain amount of flexibility in that thing, but it's also just hyper delicate. So, you know, as far as contests go, like I said, I screwed up. And what's tragic about the toe on the front wheels, I mean, on the main landing gear, was that in fact, what had happened was this had all seized up crooked when I put it together and I really couldn't adjust it. And after I schlepped this thing in a car for 2.5 hours, something loosened up. And after I was eliminated at IPMS contest, I got home and actually just twisted back. It suddenly has some flexibility where it needed to be. So in reality, I could have just popped that, but getting that all perfect and aligned is not, it's just not an easy task. It's like building a bridge with one end not connected to the other side of the river, you know, and expecting all the pieces just to go into a very complicated receiver. So that's frustrating. That's a frustrating part of this. Now about the metal legs, they were pretty nice in construction. They go into some nice metal parts. All the cross pieces were so soft they were useless because you could never get them square. So I used the plastic ones in here. You know, and I added all the wiring, of course, the brake tubes and all that aren't in there, but these are molded nicely. But you can see how much detail the resin wheels and tires have. I had trouble with the Vallejo paint sticking to these, so I couldn't mask the wheel off. I ended up hand painting the sides of the tire to get it, and then painting up against the wheel, but still came out pretty good. And I, like I said, I think that's a must have because they're huge. I'm going to show you something. So as a kid, I used to build these monogram models like crazy. I have some for future recreational building, but this is the wing of this 1/48 scale Spitfire. And that's it compared to the tail of the Mosquito. So like I said, this is a huge model. Works against it from a competition standpoint, but it makes, man, if you love Mosquitoes or you have a museum or something, this is an amazing display model. So think about it in that context. You know, it's not some delicately detailed little, you know, I scribed and poked in 20,000 rivet model. It's just a big, you know, chunky representation of a plane. I wish they had aftermarket ammo chutes. That would be the biggest thing this kit needs. That is just something that, you know, unless you're some kind of master modeler who does castings, you're not easily going to be able to replicate that. Pretty much the rest of this detail was able to be done with styrene, at least in my garage, my shop. Speaking of shops, I didn't have many tools, so you don't need to have some massive equipment list. You know, it's kind of the standard thing: side cutters, pliers, lead wire, you know, knives and tweezers, and then a lot of paint and glue. That's all I use. So here are the panels for the engine. Most of the Mosquitoes, well, at least of all the Mosquitoes of the era that I modeled, which is late 1943 and then 1944, had these nighttime flame dampeners, which burned like crazy. They were really kind of a bad, it was a good idea that didn't work very well. But anyway, there was no detail whatsoever on the inside of these. That's added styrene. And one of the things is you cannot put these on if you use the exhaust stacks. So the exhaust stacks don't fit into the space properly. That's as close as it gets. So they say chop off the exhaust stacks if you want to use the put these on. So I took one of these and gouged the crap out of the inside of it to see if I could get it to fit. I kind of did, but I never quite got to the end, and I didn't want to damage the, I didn't want to kind of grind through. So it may be possible if you want to have the option of taking these off. You have to really commit to grinding out all of the material out of the inside of that, as well as where it fits into the cowling piece. So just keep that in mind. It's not just, oh, you finish it and you can choose whether or not to put these on. No detail at all on these either. These will actually go on reasonably well and sit on there. But you know what? The weight of that nacelle and the engine and everything actually creates a misalignment here. So I couldn't set that on there for a contest. I'd have to glue it in and really position that neatly and probably glue it to the front. But the top, you know, and again, the bottom ones are not removable. That's a structural thing to hold up the engine. So you have no, if you think it'd be cool to cut that off, don't. Because unless you make these engine mounts out of metal, you'll never hold this weight with what's in the kit. Tamiya makes they screw the engine through the firewall. I don't know if that would work in this case. You need a really hefty screw to do it. But anyway, that's another fun thing is that Airfix molded the scoop into the halves. So when you put the two halves of the nacelle together, you have to deal with all the fitting and filling and everything on here. There is a, you know, these had a filter over the front, a heating element thing, which is really crudely modeled. I left it off. They used to make a photo etch one and I couldn't find it. It's been out of production too long. So firewall detail was really poor. I had to add the ribs and things like that. So the whole kit just ignores the fact that the inside of things that you can see and you might display actually have structural elements. They're just non-existent at all in this kit, except the door. The door is nicely detailed there. You have the option of a folded up ladder in there or the ladder, which I don't have handy right now. So that was long, but you know, if you're going to really invest in the time to build this model right, it's going to be a long project. So hopefully you can kind of avoid some of the pitfalls that I had, and also, and kind of enjoy your build with somebody looking out for you. There's a build thread on both the Airfix forum on airfix.com and also in large scale models that details all the step-by-step things I did and how I poured so many hours into this thing. So that's pretty much it. Good luck with your model, and let me know if you have any questions.